Ready? Good evening. Great to see everybody in the room here tonight, and hello to those online. Welcome to 19 Miles from Music Row, live in Franklin, Tennessee, and streaming from some whiz-bang satellite somewhere in outer space somewhere or something. So glad to have everybody here, both in person and online. It's really, really good to have folks in the room here. I want, on behalf of the 19 Miles of Committee, I want to welcome you. That committee that works really hard. It consists of Bill Deaton, Jody Todd, Rusty Harmon, Cortland Fuqua, Denny Wayne Rudolph, and yours truly, Dan Keene. Hello. And these cats are very skillful and hardworking and bring great stuff to this endeavor. And we thank you for coming out here tonight. All right. Good. That's for you guys. Before we bring our luminary guests up, well, I need to share something. And it's deep, and it's a burden that I've had for the whole 2 years we've been doing this, and I just didn't know if I should do anything about it, but I feel like I just have to, and I almost wore my academic regalia even tonight to do this, because you see, as a professional educator at Belmont University, I'm troubled, deeply troubled. My feeling is that whenever we gather in groups like this, there should be profound lessons taught and measurable learning outcomes and things, and on topics of deep intellectuality, you know? And, you know, for the past 2 years, I mean, we've had really great, lots of hit songs and stuff, but they're just these songs about love and relationships and partying and sinning and crying, and there's been nothing about science. Science! Until now. Yes, because, friends, for example, I feel like the field of entomology, that's bugs, insects, and things like that, I find that field of entomology woefully underrepresented at our shows. And we've got to do something about this. So, because, you know, bugs, entomology, bug lives matter. So I'm committed tonight to correcting this deficiency in our cultural psyche, you know, the cultural zeitgeist, and filling that hole in our collective psyche by bringing in this brilliant tribute to entomology. It was written by a great songwriter out of the Northwest named Paul Schilaske. And I present to you Praying Mantis Love Affair. I want a love that's lasting and not just for a day. The kind of love the two of us can share. Might not last forever. Let's try to make it there. 'Cause I don't want a praying mantis love affair. The female mantis eats her mate when they're through making love. There's nothing left but fingernails. Want an all-consuming love, but let's draw the line somewhere. I don't want a praying mantis love affair. I saw it on a nature show last night on my TV, 'cause I could not find a football game to work. I saw that lady mantis chewing on her boyfriend's leg, and it looked just like my ex-wife chomping there. The female mantis eats her mate when they're through making sweet love. There's nothing left but fingernails and hair. I want an all-consuming love, but let's draw the line somewhere. I don't want a praying mantis love affair. I don't want a praying mantis love affair.
Hey! Oh man, thank you. I feel so much better. Here comes the plug, boys. So much better. I think we can go on now, you know, with a clear conscience and know that we will be, we have satisfied part of our mission already. Isn't that great? For the newcomers in the crowd, this is how this dealio goes down. Act one features four up-and-coming songwriters, and you can see how craftily they have snuck on stage at this moment. But we have four up-and-coming writers who are each going to, they're going to do three songs each as we go around and around and around in a writer's round. And then we'll take a quick break to reset the stage for Act Two, which we call Inside the Hits. That's going to feature legendary hit songwriter Pat Alger. You will be dazed and amazed at what Pat has to bring to us. Now, at 19 miles to Music Row, we operate just like the world-famous Bluebird Cafe, which means shh when the writers are sharing their songs, okay? We and they appreciate that. But after the show, and you can meet the writers back at the merch tables back there, and you can... you can meet them there. It's been a rough year for creative people, as you know. The folks that usually play the honky-tonks on Lower Broad and that do the stuff out here at Kimbrough's and Nightingale Theater and all the wonderful places we have out here. Been a rough year. So you can help them by visiting at the merch table and perhaps buying something, or at least offering them a 19 miles encouragement, okay? So, as always, we have brilliantly reviewed all the songwriter submissions, and we are so excited to present to you tonight four mind-boggling, cerebellum-wrenching, cortex-scrambling songwriters for your dancing and dining pleasure. So let's meet them. What do you say? Yeah. On your left is Lance Cowan. I have known of Lance for a long time. He's been around here doing some great things, but we never really got to meet until that I know of till tonight. It's a real pleasure to meet Lance. He's from Calvert City, Kentucky. How'd you get into music, Lance? Is it a family thing or what?
No, I needed a job. And
wait, you picked music?
And I know, crazy. Yeah, I actually met. I was working for the Nashville Banner, if you remember that newspaper, and I met the vice president of the Country Music Hall of Fame at the Bluebird one night, and she said she knew of a job that was opening up at Network Inc., so I became a publicist, which is what I do for my bills now, as I represent artists as a publicist, but I always wanted to be a songwriter, and I get to hang out with some great songwriters and work with some great songwriters, so it's worked out pretty well.
Well, and it's always great when we have an executive that also writes, because everybody writes, you know, the label people, the publisher writes. We get to hear their songs for a change after they've been featuring everybody else's. So it's going to be a real treat, Lance. Thank you for coming.
Hope so.
Lance Cowan.
Thank you.
All the way from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, through my class, publishing class at Belmont, and to this stage is the lovely Emily Summers. Emily's from Pittsburgh. How'd music come into your life, Emily?
I've been singing for as long as I can remember, and as a kid, I used to fill composition books and notebooks with little poems that I would just like, written word and language has always just been so important to me and just come to me. But when I was about 12, my dad got my older brother a guitar for Christmas that he didn't even want. And it just kind of sat in his room collecting dust for months, and I really wanted to learn how to play, so I used to steal it while my brother was gone and teach myself in secret how to play guitar. And then once I started doing that, my poems became songs.
Yeah.
And I knew from that point on that was what I wanted to do.
Oh, that's wonderful. That's part of my story, too. My mom, there are two of us, and I got piano lessons, and my brother got the guitar lessons. He didn't like them. So it's the same thing, man. I took that guitar, and here we are, Emily. Yeah. Well, welcome, Emily Summers. And from Camden, South Carolina, we got a couple of Carolinians with us tonight. From Camden is Dwayne Clyatt. Dwayne, how are you? Thanks
for
coming over.
Wonderful.
Good. What's your story about music, man?
Started singing as a small kid, grew up in church. We didn't have instruments in the church I came from down in South Carolina, so you had to be able to stay in key or else everybody knew. And then I started playing piano, and I was writing. I was writing songs instead of learning my lessons. And when I would go into my class with my teacher, I would be ill-prepared. But I started playing a little bit of the stuff I had to her, and I didn't realize at the time I was writing. I started writing when I was about 14, started performing by the time I was 16, and by the time I was 18, I left high school and hit the road playing, and I must not have done very well, because a lot of people don't know me when I go places. However, struggle's real and I'm still trying, but thrilled to be here, man. It's so awesome to get back out and play again. Appreciate you guys coming.
Well, Dwayne, welcome. Yeah. And from Rock Hill, South Carolina, Teresa Guidry. Hello, Teresa.
Hello.
How are you?
I'm doing good. I'm so excited to be here. This is probably my first show. I was talking to a lot of the other artists, like the first show in like a year. So
yeah.
I'm really excited to be on a stage. This is awesome.
Oh, man. Well, I'm really glad you came out. What's your music story?
I mean, I was just a kid who liked music my whole life. I always wanted to be part of plays. I was always terrorizing everybody in my house by like singing really loudly in the shower or in my room at all times of the night. I have my dad like banging on the wall constantly trying to get some sleep. But you know, I just was always fascinated by music. I was always wanting to sing. My dad actually gave me this guitar right here when I was 15. It was his guitar. He had this guitar for like, I don't know, 10, 15 years, and he decided to give it to me when I was 15 because he could see that I was so interested in learning to play. And after that, that's when I really started diving into songwriting and moved to Nashville when I was 20 to kind of just take a chance and do it, and been here about 7 years.
Oh, I'm glad you did. Yeah. Is that a Martin?
This is.
And it's thin. Would you mind turning it sideways and showing the crowd? Usually, are we call dreadnought models, like this one, big old smaller shoulders, rounded but thick. And would you call that a parlor guitar, or what model number is
this?
This
is a Sigma, a Martin. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Well, that's neat.
Yeah.
Especially that you got it from your dad. That's sweet.
We've been through a lot together.
Yeah, that's great. Well, Teresa, why don't you kick us off? Ladies
okay.
and gentlemen, here we go.
Alright guys, the first song I'm going to play for you guys tonight is actually a brand new single of mine. I wrote this song a few years back, but I finally just got it recorded and put out a music video about 2 weeks ago, and CMT featured it. So that was really exciting, big deal for me, really exciting thing to happen for me in 2021 after kind of just a year of silence. So. I'm going to play that one for you, and I would so love if you guys would look it up afterwards and stream it, play the music video, because it was a lot of fun to make, and I'm really proud of it. So here's Paris. Wanna settle down with a southern man, with kind eyes, a good heart, and strong hands. Wanna see the world, be a free girl, with Must I sit on dreams and adventures? He's perfect, I know it. He's kind and devoted. My heart is torn in two. Don't wanna choose. I wanna live two lives. Blaze a trail, be your wife. I wanna hold your head. Bottle Tahitian sand. Run the streets of space. Stand in the London rain. I feel it every time that we kiss. Part of me wants this, but part of me wants Paris. Wanna buy some land, wanna build a house with a picket fence and a couple kids in a small town. Wanna backpack through Italy. Wanna drink some wine on the hillside of Tuscany. It's perfect, I know it, but he had me homesick. My heart is torn in two. Don't wanna choose. I wanna live two.
This song long before I came to Nashville. I was, came off the road, and just sometimes you have a feeling that comes over. It was literally the old story, 15-minute type deals, and you get lucky sometimes. And when I came to Nashville, I was only here like 5 or 6 months. I got picked up by these two producers, and they started running me on all the labels and started getting holes. And but when we were going to the meetings, we were cutting these songs that we were writing over here. And they were cool and all, you know, right? But I wanted my stuff to have some steel guitars and some organs on them, you know? I wanted some gospel vocals in the background. And they was like, nah, that don't work. That won't work. Fair enough. I disagree. So when we went into the labels, we got in front of the executives. They couldn't decide what I played. So I would play this. And we got called back. I ain't saying this is why it happened. It was probably the stuff that we turned in, the other stuff, but story I'm rolling with. It's called a story. She says she's leaving. That's a new way. See, I'm gone. So he bowed his head. Knowing he's been wrong. No words.
final liberty, please. Before she's gone, he says, forgive me, yeah. He said, I'm sorry, you didn't hold me nothing. As he said, it all before. Now crying to passion, passion to pain. He still tries to belong, but she lost his way. He'll say, forgive me, yeah. He'll say, I'm sorry, you didn't hold me nothing. He said it all before, and she'll say, need be.
Thank you guys, very kind, very kind.
Wow, that was great. hi, I'm Emily. This song I'm gonna play is called How Long. I just released it about a month to 2 months ago. It's a single off of my upcoming EP, Morning, which is part of a two EP project called Evening and Morning. Which is just filled with songs about, you know, the dichotomy between times in our life when we're in places of longing or struggle or confusion versus other times when we're in a place of peace or new understanding, and just the recognition that that's always a cycle, and everything that we experience is somewhere on that spectrum, and it's still all very beautiful. So this song is called How Long, and it's on the Morning EP that's coming out later in June, but the song is already out, so if you like it, then you can find it there.
Take a sip of bitter wine, let it trickle down your throat. Tell yourself you're doing fine, button up your winter coat. if it's difficult to breathe in all that frigid air around you, tell yourself again the reasons they'd be better off without you. Take another step toward the life you know you never wanted. Whisper to the window, Lord, I wonder how long, long must we wait? How long, must we pray? Of seven dreams of going up in space, but by the time you reach 11, mama puts them in their place. They all celebrate how far you've come and say with widened arms, watch out world, it's another golden child, another superstar. Take one careful step toward the life you said you always wanted, and one day you can join the world in singing. How long, must we wait? $1 million, build that house by the riverside, travel all the world and realize you're still not satisfied.
I'm going to do something dangerous and retune real fast. It's nice to be out here tonight. Last time I played was in February last year. And it's nice to play for somebody that, you know, my wife gets tired of hearing me play. Of course, you may be the same. By now I'd have the knack of traveling alone, but it's just me in this old car on 1,000 miles of broken tar, and I just saw a falling star so far, so good, so far from home. Folks all miss me so. Maybe not, well, who could know? 'Cause things like that
a touch and go, but what's a man to do? I'm out here on this interstate. It's 3 a.m. and I'm wide awake, and as long as this old car don't break, so far, so good, so far from home. And the ones I love, and all I'm thinking of is turning this car around. Another cup of coffee black, another ache in my poor back. You think by now I'd have the knack of traveling alone. But when I'm old and when I'm tired, I'll sit home and I'll stoke the fire. But until then, I'm up for hire. So far, so good, so far from home. So far, so good.
Talented people up here tonight. This is awesome. That's one thing I miss about playing writer's rounds too, is like getting to go out and see all these new artists and hear new music and get inspired and stuff. It's kind of how I started here in Nashville. I'm gonna play you guys one of my songs called Red Wine. Wrote this a few years back. I do have it on some little EPs that I'm gonna be selling here after the show, so if you like it, that's where you can find it. And here we go. This song's called Red Wine.
Red, red wine, we drank by candlelight. We were in bed that night. You looked into my eyes, and I heard you meant it when you said that you were spending all your love on the rest of our lives. Yeah, I felt your hand shaking when you said you would have taken back all those times you fed me lies. Regret, rewind, you changed your mind. It must have been the red, must have been the red wine. Red wine. Red. Memories in my bed at night turned to a bottle and to soaked ice, and it stains my lips all dark, trying to drown my broken heart. Could have sworn that you meant it when you said that you were spending all your love on the rest of our lives. Yeah, I felt your hands shaking when you said you would have taken back all those times you fed me lies. Regret, rewind, you changed your mind. It must have been the red, must have been the red wine. Regret, rewind, you changed your mind.
Slow song all night long. This is a song we had been going out and playing some shows, doing the label thing for a time, and I was not really into what I was playing at the shows, to be quite honest. I wrote it, but I wrote it with other people and whatever, and there's nothing wrong with that system. It's worked for decades and decades, and it's produced bajillions of dollars for two or three people. However, I was kind of not enjoying myself, but I had this good friend of mine named Steve Dean, man. He's a massive songwriter in Nashville, and he was always cool. You know, I could always just talk to Steve and be like, hey, man, I think it stinks, but this is what we're doing, you know. But when I wrote with him, I could pour my heart out. You know, I could say what I wanted to say. And one of these times I'd come in and I had decided on the way home that trip that I was done with this deal. You know, we're gonna write real music and we're gonna tell the stories. And one of my stories, and you'll hear this maybe reviewed again on the next one, I live hard. And hard. And gotten some bad situations, you know, along the way. And it's 100% of the reason why my success, I believe, wasn't better, just simply because I never turned down a good party. Even if it wasn't a party, I'd make it by myself, you know. And that becomes a lot more important than playing guitars and practicing and singing. So this song is called 1,000 Miles. It comes from deep down in my soul. I started playing just through this progression with Steve and just started rambling this stuff off. And that went on for like 5 or 6 minutes, you know. And when we got done, we organized it. And the name of the song was called 1,000 Miles.
In the morning light with a cloudy mind, drunk and red and bloodshot eyes. I swore I'd quit the neon light once again, while I come the moonlight rises. I know someday I'll pay for my sins. And looking through the darkness, I'll see. I'm 1,000 miles from where I've been, 1,000 miles from where I thought I'd be. Ran away from my hometown. Broke a heart and left it shattered on the ground. I hated myself for what I did, and all the pain I must have left her crawling in. She gave me all the love she had. Why'd that scare the hell out of me? Yeah. I'm 1,000 miles from where I've been, 1,000 miles from where I thought I'd been. I'm dying.
1,000 miles and we're out there. 1,000 miles and we're out there.
So my new music that I'm putting out right now, I don't have any CDs for, but I brought some CDs of my last record called Not Nearly Home. So I wanted to play one of the ones off of that. So if you like this, I've got CDs in the back. This is called This Too Shall Pass.
There you stand, daughter of love, but sadly, dear, it's not always enough. So try not to be too sentimental, 'cause you're not nearly home. The more stills your darkest fears, but at night you feel alone. You ask me how I hope. Well, this too shall pass. This too shall pass. This too shall pass. Shall pass. Whoa. The widow sighs with lily perfume. Her child cries in the corner of that room, and I can see her eyes through the barrel of a gun. They've been whispered lies as blazing as the sun, and they too shall pass. This too shall pass. This too shall pass. This too shall pass. Oh. Thank you. daughter of love. And I won't lie and say it's always enough. But I hear a voice that tells me I'm on fire. And these bones will burn and flames take me higher. And these two shall pass. These two shall.
Nice, not only because I get to hear some great songwriters tonight, but these guys who put this together, you know, treat you like you're somebody, which is also a nice change in my day-to-day life. So I really appreciate you guys letting me jump in here. I'm a last-minute replacement for another songwriter that couldn't make it, so it was a nice surprise to me. Anyway, this is a song I wrote a few years ago. Not much to tell about it. I hope you get the meaning with them. Everybody tells me just rest easy. They don't believe it should take much time. Everybody tells me I'll find another, but they don't know this heart of mine. Everybody tells me your leaving will help me. It's for the best, they say I find. But all that they see is their own situation. They don't know this heart of mine. This heart of mine is forever. This heart of mine is for sure. Though you're gone, I can't forget ever. This heart of mine is still yours. Everybody tells me they know what I'm feeling. They've all felt worse pain sometime in their lives. Funny, but that don't bring no healing. They don't know this heart of mine. This heart of mine is forever. This heart of mine is for sure. Though you're gone, I can't forget ever. This heart of mine is still. Walked right out of my life. Now I'm praying soon you'll start longing for the heart that you left behind. This heart of mine is forever. This heart of mine is for sure. Though you're gone, I can't forget ever. This heart of mine is still. This heart of mine is still yours.
I believe this is my last song of the night. Again, my name is Teresa Guidry. I'm so happy to be out, play for a live audience. You don't know how much I've missed this. I'm really excited to chat with you guys after. And I'm going to play you a song of mine that's unreleased. It's called Pretty Girl. I wrote it for a friend who is going through a pretty bad heartbreak, and it kind of just goes through the journey of that whole experience. And while I was writing it, it was definitely very relatable and healing, but this one's called Pretty Girl. Pretty girl, Saturday night, no makeup on, got a glass of wine. Pretty girl, she's alright, she ain't going anywhere tonight, and that's just fine. She ain't wondering what he's doing, running into him. You can't see someone out while you're staying in your bed. She ain't checking her phone, it's face down on the nightstand with reruns on the TV. She's got a clear head, pretty good. Fine without him, and she's gonna take a day or two to let it sink on in. He ain't the man she thought he was, but that bullet missed her skin. She ain't wondering what he's doing, running into him. It's hard to get too down when ever been, and he'll be the same old time. She ain't wondering what he's doing, running into him. And even if she does, she'll have a clear head. She ain't checking her phone, it's face down on her desk. She's too busy being busy, getting back to happy. Pretty girl, pretty girl. All right, thank you. Thank you guys so much for having me.
All right, it's my last go around. I want to say thank you to everyone here. Exactly right, we do get treated like we're someone here. I've played, I think, most every room in Nashville at one time or another, and this is by far the best. It's not even close. That's just a fact. That's a fact. Most of the time you roll in, who are you, what time, we don't know nothing about you, just do your thing. We are very busy here. All right. I don't want to take up a whole bunch of time. I'll be back here. My name is Dwayne Clyatt. If you get halfway close to that in Google, you're going to find me. I'm the only one. So we did it like that on purpose. I have to tell a little story about this one. I apologize to the writers up here, because otherwise this song is just going to lay out there. I wasn't even going to do this, but this song is the reason that I came back to playing music again, because I had probably bailed, okay? So I'll try to get through this. 2015, I lost my oldest son to an accidental drug overdose, all right? He was smoking weed. Had some stuff on it, and he had some other stuff in his system. He passed away. I didn't deal with it worth a dime. You know, I kind of did everything but deal with it. About 17 months later, almost to the day, my only brother that I grew up with, and he and I were tight. We had a kind of a tough situation growing up. He decided he didn't want to be in this world anymore, so he did what people do in that situation, right? So I ran. I bought a semi-truck, and I headed out west, and I stayed on the road for weeks on end, man, and I just, I sailed away. I didn't know if I ever wanted to play again. I really didn't care, you know, because anything that's anything is kind of, and that state of mind is, doesn't matter, right? So I ended up doing this route. I got on this run where I was going out to Idaho all the time, and I used to stop at this little place called Montpelier, Idaho, man. It's this beautiful truck stop on this two-lane roads that's just forgotten. You know, they don't have these places anymore, and I used to go in there and eat. And the little girls from the ranchers who worked in there, because the ranchers have to work a job to support their husband's ranch habit, I learned. But they had great food. And I used to sit there by myself. I never talked to them or, you know, because I just was in thought. But it was this one particular day. I was looking out this picture window, man, and I see these herd of elk. And this morning time, I'm eating my breakfast, and they're heading towards this snow-capped mountain. And I'm just like, geez, you know, nobody's ever going to believe this. And it was like that. I knew. I'm going back to Nashville, and I'm gonna share this because my gift is to write songs, right? And the Lord gave me a voice, and if I don't use it, I'm going to have to answer for that. So I went out and wrote this song. It's called Idaho Song. We're going to try to get through this, guys. Thank you so much for having me tonight.
Thumbing through an old Velcroft album that is buried in my head. Making sure to discard all the negative memories I don't want to have. Making sure to make believe everything has turned out right. With the ever always constant reminder that you're not here in this life. Please wake me in the morning. And you're in my prayers, and I'll see you again forever. I've been beat down, half dead, trying to stay up at a truck stop in Idaho. Watching them climb the mountain and the 18-wheelers roll. Where will they go? And how much further will I roam? So please wake me in the morning. Hold my hand in the moonlight and the sunrise. I know that you're there, and you're in my prayers. then I'll see you again. Forever I'm mean. I hide my eyes to hide my face under his old ball cap. Like a baby horse with blinders on, I stumble my way around, praying someday soon that I'll find a way to untie this weight around my neck. Dear Lord, have I had enough yet? And the Lord says, oh, yeah, yeah, you in the morning. And I hold Lord, your hand.
Thank you guys so much for this evening. Thank you.
Wow, this has been really wonderful. Haven't played a writer's round in about a year. I think I played this, the streaming version of this, in June of 2020. So it's so great to see your faces. Thank you so much for coming out, and this has been a blast. This song I'm about to sing, I'll close out with a song called Road to Livingston. It's just about, to take it way back to the beginning of the show, Teresa, your song Paris really speaks to me. That Paris side of you is one I also really relate to. I really relate to the whole song, but this song is about just that desire to have this a life that's free, a life where you can go and you can just kind of drive away and leave everything behind. And it explores how it would feel if that actually happened. This is Road to Livingston.
I wanna be on the road to Livingston. I wanna ditch this state I've been living in. No, I don't even know what's there, but I don't even think I care. I just wanna go. I got a tank full of gas and a radio, $40 cash in an open road. By the time I see that sun go down, I'll be so far from that broken old town that I once called home. Now, darling, don't you cry that I'm leaving you behind. I will keep you there in the corners of my mind all the way to. On the road to Livingston. Now I would bring you along if I thought I could. Keep a piece of this place that I thought was good. But I gotta get a brand new start. I never meant to break your heart. I hope that you know. So darling, don't you cry that I'm leaving you behind. Dig deep those roots you've been growing all this time, and let me sever mine on the road to Livingston. This entire 1,000-mile drive, all the way tonight, on the road to Livingston. I wanna be on the road to Livingston. I wanna ditch this state I've been living in, and maybe you can meet me there. In that sweet Montana air, in a little while.
Thank you so much.
I've enjoyed being here tonight. I've enjoyed hearing you guys play. It's nice to hear some good songs. Thanks, sir. Thanks for playing and sharing. A few years ago, a songwriter friend of mine, is that in tune? A songwriter friend of mine had an arrangement with his wife that he kept the kids in the day. She worked all day, and then he worked at night. So it made him responsible for the kids, getting them to and from school, feeding them breakfast, that kind of thing. And he did this for years. And one afternoon, he was watching as his oldest son was coming home from school. And he was walking home from school with all of his buddies. And he said it occurred to him that his son didn't need him quite like he used to. It was kind of a sad moment for him. Well, Nancy and I have two kids, and while they have finally moved out of our house, it's a beautiful thing. There were moments that it was kind of sad. When my youngest son went to college, it was kind of a weird feeling. Anyway, Terry and I wrote this song about, if I can remember how to play it. That you wrote me said you were doing well, but the more I read between the lines, the sadder I felt. Though you told me that you missed me, it was easy to tell that you were fine. You said you fit in easy, you found a place to stay with a little bit. You might find a job today, but just when you'd be back home, it's getting hard to say at this time. All in all, you say it's for the best. More welcome to come out anytime your new friends would like to meet me. You'd show me the sights
But every time I call, you say the time ain't right now. Well, baby, I'm the last one to keep you from your dreams. I guess that I was hoping that your dreams included me. It's hard letting go when you try to spread your wings and fly. All in all, I guess it's for the best. More and more, you need me.
For having me. Appreciate it.
Lance Cowan.
Thank you.
Emily Summers. Dwayne Pliant. And Teresa Guidry. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dwayne.
I think they like you. Hey, we're still clapping, y'all. I think they dug it, man. Thank you for being with us tonight. Thank you, guys. You're always so fabulous and reassuring to the writers. You know, the way you tune into them and appreciate what they're doing means a lot to them. So thanks again for being here. We want to also thank our sound and lights crew. Randy Gardner and Liam Todd are with us this evening helping out. So thanks, you guys. It sounds great. And we look so pretty. Yeah, thank you. So, folks, we're going to take a real quick break, and I do mean that. We're just going to change the set around, but y'all have a minute here for some snacks there, homemade cherry hand pies and some really good stuff and drinks, bathroom visit if you want to, and then come on back for Inside the Hits featuring Hall of Fame hit maker Pat Alger. Yeah, see you in just a minute. pleasure. Huh?
Thank you very much. I love your praying.
Isn't that a hoot? We should have written it. Yeah, that's a good one, isn't it? Hey, folks, if you can get to your seats, we'll begin here in just a few seconds. 1001, 1002, 1002. Need
just a little more guitar on stage.
You ready for me?
I'm ready for you, Dan.
Well, thank you, Patrick. Hi, everybody. Welcome back. How many of you got one of those cherry hand pies? Karen's getting famous for those, man. They're really good, yeah. So, hey, welcome back. Tennesseans, those who were born here and those that have been here a long time, you know, we know all those silly stereotypes that people use to label us, especially regarding our music and stuff. But one of our great favorite inside pleasures is to learn about our hit songwriters and the wide variety of backgrounds that they bring to Music City, confounding those ignorant stereotypes. And hit songwriter and artist Pat Alger is a quintessential example of that, my friends. Pat has written 20 big chart songs. 8 of them are now classic number one songs. Garth Brooks recorded The Thunder Rolls, Unanswered Prayers, What She's Doing Now, and That Summer, okay? He's had other hits recorded by Trisha Yearwood, Don Williams, Dolly Parton, Brenda Lee, Mickey Gilley, Hal Ketchum, Crystal Gayle, Kathy Mattea, and the Everly Brothers, okay? Yeah. But
Hey, thank you.
I thought maybe you'd play a bit of each song as I mentioned it. I should ask you to do that before. Anywho, where Pat Alger first found success, however, was in folk music. Before coming to Nashville, the LaGrange, Georgia native left his studies of architecture at Georgia Tech and moved to Woodstock, New York. Heard of that place? In 1973, and starred as a member of the Woodstock Mountains Review with folk legends Happy and Artie Traum. Maria Muldaur was also in the group with Pat. I have a question for you. How often do you think that hit songwriters, like hit superstar songwriters like James Taylor, record other people's songs? Very rarely. However, James and his brother Livingston recorded a Pat Alger song. The same for artists Peter, Paul, and Mary, Lyle Lovett, Nancy Griffith. So how's that for a deep dive? Huh? Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
Very much a stereotype buster. In 1991, Pat was rewarded the esteemed Nashville Songwriters Association International Songwriter of the Year Award and ASCAP's Jukebox Songwriter of the Year the same year. Yes. And in 93, Pat became ASCAP's Country Songwriter of the Year. Yeah. And then Pat's principled guy, and so during his career, later in his career, he served other writers as the two-time president of NSAI. He has been the president of the Nashville Songwriters Foundation and is still on that board helping out his brothers and sisters. Rightfully, Pat Alger was inducted into the Nashville Songwriters Hall of Fame and is one of the few songwriters in the Georgia Music Hall of Fame. With four solo albums to his credit, Pat is generously here to share all this talent with us tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, Hall of Famer, Pat Alger.
Hey, thank you. Wow. Thank you very much. I'm a little rusty. I've been sitting at home, and it's really hard to practice singing at home. It really is. I get started on a song, and then I'll think of something else, and the next thing you know, I'm washing the dishes or something. So, but I was playing all the time before the pandemic, and actually, I finally ordered a new guitar strap with my initials on it, and I never got to wear it until tonight. This is my first time. I put it in my case, and here it is, you know. I kind of feel like Waylon a little bit, you know, and Willie. But I'm just gonna play a bunch of songs. If there's something in particular you want, if I can remember the lyrics, I'll try to play it. You know, I don't know what to do anymore. It's been so long, but I'm going to play a song that is very dear to me. I came here because I wanted to get a song recorded by Don Williams, and he was my hero. I heard him sing a song called Till the Rivers All Run Dry, and I thought, if that's what they're doing in Nashville, that's what I want to do too. And sure enough, I came to Nashville, and 12 years later, Don Williams got one of my songs. You just have to show up and stay until they do it, you know. Adam met Eve on a Saturday night. That's when the trouble started. She said, Adam, let's go get a bite. Led him to the garden. And ever since we try to make sense of this mystery emotion, well, we might as well try to count the stars in the sky or those raindrops in the ocean. Cause don't you know true love is deeper than me. It's hotter than a fire.
hard to find, and it's harder to keep. It's the thing we most desire. I was alone for so many nights. I really started to wonder if I had run out of chances to find a spell I could fall under. And you walked in like in an Elvis film. You were singing Love Me Tender. I was hypnotized by your blue eyes. And the next thing I remember, you know it was true love. Deeper than deep, it's hotter than a fire. Well, it's hard to find and harder to keep. It's the thing we most desire. And there is true love in a winking eye and a sweet perfume that lingers. It's an I love you on a new tattoo and that diamond on a finger. True love, deeper than deep, it's hotter than a fire. Well, it's hard to find, harder to keep. It's the thing we most desire. It's the true love we most desire.
All right. Thank you. Thank you very much. I've been a very fortunate person in my life. I've, walked in the room at the right time and met the right person, even though I probably didn't know I was doing any of those things. And I was in my office one day, and my office was over on Music Row, and which is, I'm not sure if anybody even works over there anymore, but I worked over there in a building on the corner of 16th and Horton, and originally built by cowboy Jack Clement. And I had an office there. Well, actually, it was a little bit more like a jail cell, actually. It was down in the basement, and I had one window, and it had bars on it. And so it was also made out of stone, and it was painted sort of a neutral color. So, I would make writing appointments with people, and they'd say, well, where do you want to write? I'd say, yeah, let's write at my office. They'd say, oh man, I don't want to go down there, man. That's awful. So one day I was in the same mood. I didn't want to hang out there. So I went upstairs where they actually count the money. You know, that's the best place to go if you're a songwriter. It's the place where all the royalty statements was, and I was going in there to check on something, and I came out, and my friend Alan Reynolds was coming out of his office across the street, and he had this guy with him who was dressed in a duster and a big hat, and I thought he was about 6'3", 6'4". And it turned out to be a guy named Garth Brooks from Oklahoma, and he looked like John Wayne to me. I thought, God, Alan's working with John Wayne. Anyway, we met that day and struck up a conversation. Turned out he was playing in town, and I went to see him that night at a kind of a real dumpy bar down on Church Street. And I just bought a Mercedes, and I didn't really want to park it there. And I did, though. And when I went in, this guy I'd never heard of before just sang these songs and just knocked me on my butt. And we made some appointment to write, and one day we wrote this thing right here. And I believe this song has made me more friends than any song I've ever written. Just the other night at a hometown football game, my wife and I ran into
my old high school flame. And as I introduced them, the past came back to me, and I couldn't help but think of the way things used to be. She was the one I wanted for all time, and each night I spent praying that God would make her mine. And if he'd only grant me this wish I wished back then, you'd know I'd never ask for anything again. Sometimes I thank God for unanswered prayers. Remember when you're talking to the man upstairs. Just because he doesn't answer doesn't mean he don't care. Some of God's greatest gifts are unanswered prayers. Could I get an amen? She wasn't quite the angel I remembered in my dream, and I could tell time had changed me, and her eyes too had seen. We tried to talk about the old days, there wasn't much we could recall. I guess the Lord knows what he's doing after all. Then and there I thank the good Lord for the gifts in my life. Sometimes I thank God for unanswered prayers. Remember when you're talking to the man upstairs. Just because he doesn't answer doesn't mean he don't care. 'Cause some of God's greatest gifts, yes, some of God's greatest gifts are unanswered prayer. And that's the truth. Sometimes I thank God for Garth Brooks too. Thank you. Thank you very much. I was talking backstage and I started out doing this stuff about 50 years ago plus, actually. And I actually have a picture from 1969 at this place I used to play in Atlanta where I started, and I'm sitting on a stool like this with my guitar, sitting here like this. And I have a picture of me at the Country Music Hall of Fame 2019, sitting on a stool in the same position, playing a guitar just like this. So you can say I haven't gotten very far in my life, you know, truly. But this is a song that I wrote when I first got to Nashville with a guy named Walter Carter. Walter used to be a journalist, and but he was, like everybody else in Nashville, he was trying to have a hit record, and he had quite a few of them. This one wasn't one of them, unfortunately. But this is on my new album, which someday may come out, if I can ever figure out what I'm supposed to do next. Sometimes you do, sometimes you don't. Sometimes you will, and then you won't. Sometimes you act like you love me, then you don't even know my name. Sometimes you're hot, sometimes you're cold. Sometimes you head over heels and then you're not. Sometimes you act like you love me and you don't even know my name. Sometimes you call and say, come on over, can't wait to see me alone. I put the phone down and race across town just to find nobody home. Sometimes it's pleasure, sometimes it's pain. One thing's for certain, it's a crying shame. The way you act like you love me, then you don't even know my name. Sometimes you look like a big storm coming, and then the sun starts to shine. And when I make plans, I need a weatherman just to know what's on your mind. Sometimes you're cold, sometimes you're hot. Sometimes your head over heels and then you're not. Sometimes you act like you love me, then you don't even know.
This song here, when it came out, I've had a post office box at the Ackland Station Post Office. I'm the oldest living person with the longest tenure at the Ackland Station Post Office. Still have the same box, by the way. 1681, if you want to drop by and see where it is. You know. Tell them I sent you, because they got stamps and everything there, and they're very friendly people. But I used to make a daily trip there, you know, when this song was out, some friends, you know, female friends of a certain age would come up to me and they'd say, oh, I really love that song that's out that you wrote. I go, you do? Are you trying to tell me something? I didn't do this song for a long time because I really couldn't outdo the hit version of it. But I finally came up with a way to play it that I like and just tell a story. Everybody always asks me, is that a true story? And I always say, some of it is. Yeah. I went to work for her that summer, a teenage kid so far from home. She was a lonely widow woman, hell-bent to make it on her own. We were 1,000 miles from nowhere, wheat fields as far as I could see. Both needing something from each other, not knowing yet what that might be. Till she came to me one evening,
hot cup of coffee and a smile, in a dress that I was certain she hadn't worn in quite a while. There was a difference in her laughter, there was a softness in her eyes, and on the air there was a hunger even a boy could recognize. She had a need to feel the thunder, to chase the lightning from the sky, to watch the storm in all its wonder, raging in her lover's eyes. She had to ride the heat of passion like a comet blazing bright, rushing headlong in the wind, out where only dreams have been, burning both ends of the night. That summer wind was all around me, nothing between us but the night. And when I told her that I'd never, she softly whispered, "That's all right." And then I watched her hands of leather turn to velvet in a touch. There's never been another summer when I have ever learned so much. She had a need to feel the thunder, to chase the lightning from the sky, to watch the storm in all its wonder, raging in her lover's eyes. She had to ride the heat of passion like a comet blazing bright, rushing headlong in the wind, out where only dreams have been, burning both ends of the night. Think about that summer, the sweat, the moonlight in the lace, and I have rarely held another when I haven't seen her face. And every time I pass a wheat field and watch it dancing with the wind, though I know it isn't real, just can't help but feel her hungry arms again. Though I know it isn't real, I just can't help but feel those hungry arms again. I often think about that summer.
Well, that was a hard song to write. We turned that song in, and it was actually originally called "Burning Both Ends of the Night." I'm telling all these things probably Garth doesn't want me to tell, but it was called "Burning Both Ends of the Night" when we first wrote it, and it was a really different song. And we played it for Alan Reynolds, and Alan hated it. He really hated it. He didn't say I hate it, by the way. He just, I looked at him and I knew him well enough to know, you don't like that, do you? So we wrote this song about, I don't know how many times we wrote it. I think there's only one verse that remains untouched. And turned out okay, though. Especially for women of a certain age. And I know I remember mine. I was just a puppy dog to her, though. She didn't take me seriously. But of course, you know, I was only 20 years old and she was 30, really older woman, you know. Crazy. One of the greatest things I guess I could say about my career is that I got to be friends with almost everybody that ever recorded one of my songs in the beginning of my career. And one of the people I got to be friends with was a woman from West Virginia named Kathy Matea. And if you don't like Kathy Matea, you don't like people. So she's just great people, and she's just funny. So I met her on a session, and we became real good pals. And then she got a record deal, and then I thought, well, surely Kathy will do one of my songs. And she did. I said, well, she's waiting for the second record, I know. Because she's a pal, you know, pals don't let pals down, you know. She didn't put any on the second record either. And I was getting to think, well, maybe we're not pals. But eventually, she called and said she liked this song that I'm gonna play now. But the record company kind of laid down the law for us. They said, if you don't start having some hits, you know, where it's going to be hard to keep making records. And she finally had a hit. And then she did this song, and this became her first number one record and my first number one record. So we really were pals. This is loosely based on the truth also. Yeah. The lighthouse in the song is the Cape Natick Light in Maine, and if you're ever up there, it's a beautiful place. There's a lighthouse in the harbor, giving guidance with its light. Had no one to return to as I wandered through the night. But from the first time that I saw you, standing silent by the shore, I knew my search was over. And I would look for love no more. Deep in the waters of love I am falling, sinking like a stone. Deep in my heart I can hear love calling. Going once, going twice, going once, going twice, going gone. There's a ship on the making its way against the wind. From the point where I stand watching, I swear my ship is coming in. Oh, deep in the waters of love I am falling, sinking like in my heart. I can hear love calling, going once, going twice, going gone, going once,
rocking like a stone. Deep in my heart I can hear love calling. Going once, going twice, going gone. Going once, going twice, going. Thank you. The woman I wrote that for is way over there, standing in the aisle there. It's my wife, Stacy. I got a chance to go down to the Kerrville Folk Festival in 1985, and I was asked to judge a songwriting contest, and I didn't really know what that was entailed. You know, when I got there, it's really hot in Texas in the summertime, and I discovered that what I was going to be doing was sitting outside in the sun and listening to 40 songwriters a day for 3 days and trying to stay awake enough to make a decision who is the best. And there were great songwriters. There were some fantastic songwriters. I'm sure I missed some of them, though, because it was really, really hot. And after you've heard 30 or 40 songs that you never heard before, you kind of drift off a little bit and start thinking, I wonder if I turned the stove off back home. Or, you know, did I fill up the tank with gas before I left? I can't remember. Stuff like that. Really important stuff, you know. So, here's the lucky thing. On the third day, this guy really, I mean, you know, I don't normally go on and on about stuff like this, but he was really good looking. And I thought, oh, well, he's probably not any good, you know. And we're not supposed to be judging on the performance. We're just supposed to be judging the song. So you didn't have to be a good singer, supposedly. He got up and started singing, and there were three judges, me and Katie Moffitt and Tom Russell. We all looked at each other, and I said, and I think I said, I don't know how you ignore this. This guy is really good, you know. And he sang these two songs, man. The short and the long of it is old Hal Ketchum was the winner. And I got a chance to be friends with him over the years. And I'm very sad that he was one of our great people that we lost this year. But he was a great guy. And I actually ended up, was the first time he ever co-wrote a song was with me, but he didn't tell me that until afterwards, because I thought he was an experienced co-writer, and I thought, you know, sure, let's write. And anyway, this is a big deal for him. He was going, after the song was written, he said, boy, I'm glad we got that over with. And I said, what? He said, that's the only time I've ever written a song with anybody. Thank you for telling me. But I had this other song that I had written, that I'd written for the Everly Brothers. And, but they were going in a different direction. And so I kept trying to pitch this song all over Nashville. Couldn't get anybody interested in the song. I remember taking it to one guy, and he said, nobody's going to cut that. It doesn't have a chorus. I said, well, it's got a short chorus. It's a little chorus, but it's a chorus. Just tried to sell it, you know, and they just give me my tape back and I walk home, you know. So Hal Ketchum was going in the studio, so my friend Jim Rooney
asked him as a favor to do a work tape of this song. And this is the song. It turned out to be a good idea. There's an Elvis movie on the marquee sign. We've all seen at least three times. Everybody's broke, but Bobby's got a buck. For a dollar worth of gas in his pickup truck. We're going 90 miles an hour down a dead end road. What's the hurry? Where are you gonna go? We're gonna howl at the moon, shoot out the light. It's a small town Saturday night. This is a small town Saturday night. Now Lucy's got her lipstick on a little too bright. And old Bobby's getting drunk and he's looking for a fight. Liquor on his breath and trouble on his mind. And old Lucy's just a kid who's along for the ride. They got a six pack of beer and a bottle of wine. They gotta be bad just to have a good time. And they howl at the moon, shoot out the light. It's a small town Saturday night. Yes, it's a small town Saturday night. That part of the song was pretty easy to write. Pretty much the way it happened. Changed the names to protect the guilty. Couldn't think of anything else to say about a small town. So small and all. And one day I was home working. I was laid on the couch, is what I was doing actually. I was just about to switch over from the Days of Our Lives over to the Young and the Restless. When it kind of hit me, that other thing about a small town. Now Bobby told Lucy the world ain't round. You know it dropped soft sharp, it did the town. Lucy, you know the world must be flat. Cause the people leave town and never come back. They go 90 miles an hour to the city limits, try to put the pedal to the devil for to change their mind. And they howl at the moon, shoot out the light. It's a small town Saturday night. Just they howl at the moon, shoot out the light. Cause it's a small town Saturday night. This is a small town Saturday night. Said it's a small town Saturday night. Shot who? A small town Saturday night. All right, thank you. Thank you very much. I don't know, where am I? How many minutes have I played? I can't. I'm having too much fun. I don't know where I am. That song was really about my hometown, LaGrange, Georgia, and the town that we would drive 90 miles an hour to was Noonan, which is where Alan Jackson's from. And I once, the year I was the ASCAP Songwriter of the Year, Alan Jackson had the Song of the Year. And I thought, what are the odds of that happening? You know, I mean, if you either went to either of those places, you'd go, boy, people are just lucky to get out of there. I'm just just joking. LaGrange is actually a very pretty town, and so is Noonan, which is where Alan's from. He's got a road named after him, though, and I don't, and I'm really kind of a little ticked off about it, to be honest with you. I'm not getting any younger either, LaGrange. You know, about time. They did do a day for me. I had Pat Alger Day, October 27th. And it was kind of fun. I didn't get anything for it, though. I just got, you know, a day. And then it was gone. You know, it was like, I don't know. I thought it'd be a bigger deal, you know. I thought I'd get more excited. I don't get too excited, though. It's bad for your health. So here's another song I wrote with this guy I met in my office from Oklahoma. He and I, you know, I think I'm about 15 years older than him, but we had a lot of stuff that was in common. And he was telling me he wanted to write a song about his ex-girlfriend, and I said, well, what about her? Well, you know, I just wonder what she's doing. I said, well, where is she? He said, she's in Boulder, Colorado. I said, your ex-girlfriend's in Boulder? I said, my ex-girlfriend's in Boulder. What's her name? I just wanted to make sure wasn't the same one, you know. Boulder's kind of a small city, you know, it's not that very big. And anyway, it turns out it wasn't. But we really talked this through, and he said, oh, yeah, what's she doing now? And I said, no, it's, I wonder if she knows what she's doing now. And thus the song was born. There we go. Last time I saw her, it was turning cold. That was years ago. Last I heard, she had moved to Boulder. Where she's now, I don't know. There's something about this time of year that spins my head around, takes me back, makes me wonder what she's doing now. Is what she's doing now is tearing me apart, filling up my mind and emptying my heart. I could hear her call each time the cold wind blows, and I wonder if she what she's doing now. Just for laughs, I dialed her old number, but no one knew her name. Put down the phone and I stood there, and I ever done the same. I took a walk in the evening breeze just to clear my head somehow. But tonight I sit here thinking, what's she doing now? 'Cause what she's doing now is tearing me apart, filling up my mind and emptying my heart. I can hear her call each time the cold wind blows, and I wonder if she knows what she's doing now. Is tearing me apart, filling up my mind. Each time the cold wind blows, and I wonder if she knows
what she's doing now. What's she doing now?
Oh, thank you so much. This has been a hard year for a lot of people. I know it was, I lost a lot of friends. On February of 2020, the last show I played was at the Station Inn, and I'm in a band with a guy named Jim Ernie, and John Prine sat in with us at night. I played guitar with him, and then he was one of the first ones to go. It's very upsetting and very, very hard to deal with, really. He was friends, my wife and I both were at his wedding, and yeah, my son and his son were roommates, so it was a really tough loss. He was just a great guy. Then later in the year, the guy who actually owned the Station Inn got COVID and died also. So it was really a lot of time to think about things. So I give you this song with that in mind. The days fly by so fast, before I even know, another one's flown by and I never saw it go. Tomorrow turns into one more yesterday, and yesterday becomes a day before. I've already missed so many, but I'm not missing any anymore. I want to breathe in every breath that I've got left. Waste no time living in regret. I'll let what's gone be gone and just keep moving on. I want to feel each new emotion, from a teardrop to an ocean, not let one precious moment pass, as long as I'm still on the green side of the grass. There's some who just give up before they've even tried, and others dig a hole before they've even died. And I've been down both roads and wasted so much time, as if life would just be waiting at my door. I was foolishly mistaken, a mistake that I'm not making anymore. I want to breathe in every breath that I've got left. Waste no time living in regret. I'll let what's gone be gone and just keep moving on. I want to feel each new a teardrop to an ocean, not let one precious moment pass, as long as I'm still on the green side of the grass. What's the hurry, friend? There's no better place to be. We both know how this ends. So stay a little while with me and we'll just
a teardrop to an ocean. Not let one precious moment pass. As long as I'm still home, the green side of the grass. As long as I'm still on the green side of the grass. What's the hurry, friend?
Thank you so much. I'm not sure what a lot of you were doing during the pandemic. I know it's a crazy time. I got married. That's what I did. And my beautiful bride. We were together a long time ago, and finally came to our senses. And out of the blue, we kind of started a new life at a time when life, in so many ways, seemed to be coming to an end, and I feel very fortunate to have her in my life. And I did write some songs during this time, and this is for Stacy. Take things as they come, and I watch them as they go. As certain as the setting sun, there's one thing I still know. My heart is overflowing. Questions fill my mind. Answers come so slowly. I know I'll just run out of time, so I will meet you in the dark again to open up my soul, mend my heart a little as you keep me from the cold. And I'm grateful for each humble gift you're willing to bestow. The one reward remaining now that I'm growing old. Friends constantly remind me there's so much left to do, so I agree reluctantly to stir that witch's brew. No going back to the beginning, or even somewhere in between. I make do with what I'm given, and that's enough for me. And I will meet you in the dark again to open up my soul and mend my heart a little. For each humble gift you're willing to bestow, it's the one reward remaining now that I'm going home. I'm learning to accept it. I can't avoid the simple truth. The things that I find missing are lost now to my youth. I wake each day and wonder what on earth will pull me through. But when the light is fading, I return again to you. And I'm
the one reward remaining now that I'm going home. It's the one reward remaining now that I'm going home. I take things as they come, I watch them as they go.
All right. Thank you. I'm doing some songs you haven't heard before, if that's okay, and I'm going to close with one pretty soon that you have. This is a song that I wrote with my friend Ralph. Oh, I wanted to mention that the song Green Side of the Grass, I wrote that with a guy named John Vesner, one of my best friends and one of the greatest songwriters I know. And I mentioned trying to get him here for a show. He'd be great. This is a song I wrote with one of my best pals who passed away recently also. We were both avid gardeners, and he just planted his Brussels sprouts, and he came in and had this idea for a song. And it doesn't happen to everybody. Don't you? Every time you think about Brussels sprouts, you go, God, I need to write today. I really do. This song, though, is I played this at his memorial, and I played it at my mother's too. And but it's not a sad song; it's a really sweet song, and it's about the, you know, pretty much the way I feel. I'm in a Methodist church, and I was saved by the Methodist church. My life could have ended really different than it did, but I joined the Boy Scouts and the Methodist Youth Fellowship, and both of those things together kind of saved me from a life of petty crime and trouble. And I'm very, very grateful for the Methodist Church for that. I was baptized in a lake, you know, in my clothes, you know. I didn't have a lot of clothes, and I didn't have a change of clothes after I got dunked, and I had to go home wet. So it was a day I'll never forget. Anyway, this is a song I wrote with Ralph Murphy called Seeds. Sometimes I stop on my way home to watch the children play, and I wonder if they wonder what they'll be someday. Some will dream a big dream and make it all come true, while others go on dreaming things they'll never do. We're all just seeds in God's hands. We start the same, but where we land is sometimes fertile soil, sometimes sand. We're all just seeds in God's hands. I saw a friend the other day I hardly recognized. He'd done a lot of living since I last looked in his eyes, and he told his tale of how he'd failed and the lessons he'd been taught. But he offered no excuses, and he left me with this thought: we're all just seeds
not the same. But where we land is sometimes fertile soil and sometimes sand. We're all just seeds in God's hand. And as I'm standing at the crossroads once again, I'm reminded we're all the same when we begin, and in the end, we're all just seeds in God's hand. We start the same, but where we land is sometimes first. Sometimes sand. We're all just seeds in God's hand. We're all just seeds in God's hand.
Close out here with another song I wrote with my buddy Garth. Thank you all for coming. Appreciate it. Hope we had a good time. Heard some good songs in the beginning, I know. Great song. Great to see young songwriters going at it and still writing great songs. And I came here because songwriting was in the air, and it still is. And it's a very, very comforting thought. Thanks for doing this here at the church. Thanks to Dan and everyone that's involved. Good little thing. So here's a song that is not a true story. Three 3:30 in the morning, not a soul in sight. The city's looking like a ghost town on a moon. Raindrops on the windshield as a storm moving in. He's headed back from someplace he never should have been. And the thunder rolls. And the thunder rolls. Every light burning in a house across town. She's pacing by the telephone in a faded flannel gown, asking for a miracle, hoping she's not right, praying it's the weather that's kept him out all night. And the thunder rolls. Thunder rolls, thunder rolls, and the lightning strikes. Another love grows cold on a sleepless night. The storm blows on out of control. Deep in her heart, she's waiting at the window, and he pulls into the drive. She runs out to hold him, thankful he's alive. And on the wind and rain, a strange new perfume blows. Story, but Garth Brooks wasn't the first person to record this. This was initially recorded by a great singer named Tanya Tucker. She really liked it a lot, but a producer called me one day and before they recorded it and said, "Hey, I want to talk to you about this song. Tanya and I don't think it's finished." Jerry Crutchfield, great guy. Jerry had a real gravelly voice. He said, "Pat, we want something to happen there at the end." And I said, "What? What are you talking about?" He said, "Well, Danny and I think somebody ought to die." I think I said something like, "Any particular way?" And he actually had a way in mind, you know. We talked about it a little bit, and I said, "Well, okay, I'm going to call Garth, and we'll have this on your desk in the morning." And I called up Garth, and I said, "Look, hey, here's the good news. They still love our song. Here's the bad news. We got to kill somebody tonight." Neither one of us really wanted to do that, I tell you. And, anyway, we kind of wrote about three or four different scenarios, and finally this is the one we came up with. And I gave it to Jerry, and they thought it was cool. And if you Google it on YouTube, you can see Tanya singing this. She got it first. She runs back down the hallway through the bedroom. Me playing on the record, by the way, playing this part. And the thunder roll. Thank you very much. Thanks for coming. I really appreciate it. You're very kind. Thank you. Thanks so much. It's such a pleasure to play for people again. Especially nice people. Thank you. Thank you very much. Very, very kind of you.
Pat, welcome back out of hibernation, brother. You did a good, good job. Thank you very, very much. Again, Pat Alger. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And thank you, folks, for coming out. And folks at home, appreciate you too. Couple things. There's a little donation box in the back. If you can contribute a little bit so we can keep this going and treat the writers the way we want to treat them, that would be very helpful. Thank you so much. And also, I want to mention that our Act One writers will be in the back of the room here at the merch tables. Please stop by there and give them a little encouragement if you can. And we will see you next month. Our Inside the Hits section is going to be led by hit songwriter Jason Matthews. So we'll see you then. Thanks again. Thank you, Pat.